Welcome to LCTV Live on location in the pub. Tonight we're teaming up with Sports Zone in front of a live audience.
We have a jam-packed show filled with plenty of news and sports for you.
That's right. See what cool project the engineering department seniors are working on.
And where Sam Lozada will be taking us in this week's Bites of the Tri-States.
Well, that sounds great, guys. We have a lot lined up in sports for you tonight. And we'll reveal the winner of the LCTV March Madness Bracket Challenge.
And you will never guess who I'm talking to later on in the show. So ladies and gentlemen, sit back, relax, grab a seat, and maybe something to eat. LCTV Live is about to begin.
Our top story tonight, an investigative follow-up story about the shots that were fired a block from Loras last week. Just before 10:30 Wednesday night, police were called at the corner of Pickett and Henyon Streets for a report of possible gunshots. They told LCTV that they found bullet casings at the scene, but no damage and no one was injured. Police say they believe the gunman was on foot, but campus did not go on lockdown.
Loras Campus Safety posted an alert to the portal and sent out a campus-wide email approximately 13 hours after the reported shots. Many students have been asking why there was no lockdown and why the campus did not use the emergency alert system.
LCTV reporter Sarah Rochford met with Dubuque police and campus officials to get answers. Sarah?
There's that fine line in the sand between where Loras Campus Safety ends and the local police department begins. Loras had to decipher between the two in the incident that occurred last Wednesday night.
We do have great working relationships with all of our colleges.
We want to provide the information that's important for people to have in order to be safe and go about the business that they have, but at the same time be cautious in doing that so that we're providing accurate information and how does it pertain to us, doesn't pertain to us.
Police were made aware of shots fired, as was Loras Security. When the question of lockdown came into play, both parties deemed it not needed.
It was contained, and early on, based on past intelligence and a couple recent incidents, we were very confident there wasn't any affiliation with Loras.
And at the time, police said that it wasn't a matter for us to lock down the campus or to do anything other than what they were doing, because they were handling it. One, it was off campus, and two, the nature of the incident, as they determined, was not a threat to our students or our campus.
So it's a tough decision to make, and again, we don't always make the right one, but we try to based on the information we have. And you know, student safety is, just like it's Loras' top priority, it's ours as well.
Separated only by a parking lot, Pickett Street is a block away from three of the main resident halls on campus, giving students a front row seat to the sights and sounds of the investigation.
I was outside on the phone, and two cars hit each other, and then I heard about four or five shots.
While many heard the shots and saw the lights, they woke up the next morning still wondering what happened. Answers came just before the noon hour.
I was aware of it that night, and then through the morning got more information so that then we could notify the campus. The challenge with that is having the best information to share it.
Police and campus officials say they have a responsibility to release appropriate information at appropriate times.
This is very active and ongoing. And we obviously have to be careful when we do release information that we don't compromise our case.
So there's always this balance between what folks want to know and what they need to know. We don't keep anything from folks. It's part of us is just getting the information ourselves. So what is it that we should be communicating out?
Now guys, I spoke with Art Sunleaf personally, and I expressed to him, you know, the questions that I constantly kept hearing around campus, which was why weren't students informed of the situation when it happened that night. He told me that via text message with the emergency alert system, he said that it would be irresponsible to send anything like that out too soon without confirming that with police and any information that they have. So Matt and Rye, back to you guys.
The Loras Neuroscience Department is getting into mischief thanks to a generous donation from an alumnus. The department recently acquired a mischief of more than 75 mice in a new state-of-the-art lab. Students use the lab to run tests and conduct research. Right now, they're studying the impact of social isolation.
Mice are a fairly good model of human physiology and human behavior. They have, even though they're very tiny, they have relatively advanced brains, and for the most part, all of their bodily systems are similar to what you'd find in a human, just obviously on a smaller scale.
In the past, Loras students had to travel to other research facilities to conduct these kinds of experiments. They say having this new lab at the undergraduate level is extremely beneficial.
Over in the engineering department, four students are taking flight with their senior capstone project. After months of research and tireless hours of building, Daniel Trotwine, Anthony Egging, Juan Perez, and Jana Krasenpanthi are almost finished with their quadcopter. The unmanned aerial vehicle, or UAV, prototype is in the final stages of testing. The group of seniors hopes to have the finishing touches done in the next few weeks. One addition will include an attached GoPro camera that will provide live aerial video coverage around campus.
DoHawks will be well represented at the Cedar Rapids Film Festival this weekend. 40 films will be screened during the three-day festival. Six of those are produced by Laura's students. The festival takes place at the Collin Rhodes Theater in Marion, where each film will be shown not once, but twice. A list of showtimes will be available at your fingertips on mydohawk.com.
This week, Laura's students have had the chance to elect their student union president for the next year. There are two candidates running for the position, Andrew Sitari and Nick Utter, both juniors. Sitari's platform emphasizes the student union and what can be done to improve the relationship that the organization has with Laura students. Utter's platform emphasizes tackling issues such as food waste in the CAF and better communication between students and the administration. Voting will be online. Polls open tomorrow on OrgSync, and you can find a link on the portal.
In honor of the 175th year anniversary, Loras College is aiming to reach 175,000 volunteer hours. Students, faculty, alumni, and friends are encouraged to log any and all volunteer hours they have completed to help reach the goal. You can find a link to log your service hours on mydohawk.com.
This semester, LCTV's international correspondent Maria Adolphs has been showing us the sights and sounds of Lisbon, Portugal.
But tonight, she's taking us to another capital city in Western Europe.
Hey guys, I've traveled the big north of Lisbon to a city I think you will recognize. I want to welcome you to London. The sights of this city are some of the most recognized places in the world. The House of Parliament, Kensington Palace, Trafalgar Square, and especially Buckingham Palace, home of Queen Elizabeth II. London is the perfect place to discover everything royal. At Madame Tussauds Wax Museum, you can decide whether William or Harry is your Prince Charming and stand toe-to-toe with the entire family. London is also home to the world's most famous address. 221B Baker Street was the residence of Sherlock Holmes and Dr. Watson. Today, visitors can explore rooms such as Sherlock's study or Dr. Watson's bedroom. Here comes the sun. While hopefully looking over Abbey Road, that is, your trip isn't complete without a stop where the famous photo of the Beatles was taken. There is nothing like the spirit of London, and when you leave the city, it might just steal a little piece of your heart. In London, Maria Adolphs, LCTV News.
Join us back in the studio May 7th when Maria will take us on a tour of the Emerald Isle.
In light of National Architecture Week, Dubuque is doing a little celebrating. Dubuque Main Street has partnered up with local businesses for its 8th annual Architecture Days. The week is filled with tours showcasing the theme of sacred spaces. Guests can tour St. Raphael's Cathedral and the former St. Mary's Church, along with other religious establishments in the area. Tours will continue throughout the week. Go to mydohawk.com for all information.
Many of us have experienced the frustration of getting stuck waiting at a railroad crossing, but a new proposal may put an end to the struggle in Dubuque. The engineering department is considering the construction of two railroad bridges as a part of the city's long-range transportation plan. The first overpass would provide vehicular access over the tracks crossing 14th Street. It would begin at the Washington Street intersection and end at Cedar Street. The second project would be a pedestrian overpass from B Branch Creek Trail to the Canadian Pacific Rail Yard. The city is researching potential funding sources for the estimated $20 million project.
Senior High School opened its doors to families of students with special needs this week. On Monday, the Dubuque Community School District welcomed parents and guardians of pre-kindergarten to 12th grade special needs students. The resource fair is held every 3 years and aims at connecting those with disabilities to the various resources in the community.
What we have here tonight is a mirage of different agencies, support groups, colleges, employment programs that all help our youth with disabilities prepare for their adult life.
More than 30 agencies and groups were on hand to provide information about available resources.
The Dubuque City Youth Ballet and the Heartland Ballet Academy debuted Swan Lake this past weekend. The ballet focuses on the life of a carefree Prince Siegfried, played by Francis Mim. His mother wishes that he gets married, but he wants to wait to fall in love. He meets Odette, played by Megan McLeod, a swan who turns into a maiden by night. Through a series of events, the two fall in love.
It is one of the most dramatic, technical, difficult, inspiring ballets there is.
Tickets are still on sale, so don't worry if you missed out. You can catch another performance of Swan Lake this weekend at the Grand Opera House.
Now that spring weather is finally here, we can't stop thinking about sunshine and all the fun that warm weather brings.
And no doubt about it, one of the best warm weather treats is ice cream. So Sam Lozada is giving us a scoop in this week's Bites of the Tri-States.
Cars pass through this intersection here at Asbury Road every day, but one local business has been here longer than most can even imagine.
Well, the ice cream's been here for 34 years. Built onto the business from the gas station, started with the gas station, the beverage store, to the ice cream.
Beecher's Ice Cream has finally opened its doors for the summer, and this family shop is something that Brian Beecher grew up with.
Actually, it was my dad. He used to run a rock quarry. And he sold the rock quarry about 35 years ago, and he has a real bad sweet tooth.
And this business, run by a father and son, is now going into its next generation.
Like, I used to help my dad, and then he got a little bit older, so he said he was going to give it up, so I brought my son into it, and he helps me with it now.
I enjoy it. It's pretty cool knowing that whenever somebody always talks about how good our ice cream is, it's kind of pretty cool knowing that I'm one of the two people who make most of it.
Beecher's has more than enough to satisfy loyal customers with more than 35 flavors from M&M and Oreo to your old favorite vanilla. But Brian says that the best part of this business is that everyone always has a smile on their face.
It's one thing about this business, an ice cream business, everybody's always happy.
Brian has been seeing some of those smiles for a long time.
You got people that have been coming in here for 30 years that I can imagine that they sit out here and eat ice cream every day at practically, so.
For Bites of the Tri-States, I'm Sam Lozada.
Well, we have a lot to get to into sports right now.
So after the break, we have highlights galore as four Duakim were all in action.
And I'm taking my skills to the golf course. Stay tuned.
It's a party in the USA.
Yeah! It's a party.
You're crazy.
I guess it can wait.
What do you guys want to do?
I don't know. What do you want to do?
I don't know. What do you want to do?
1, 2, ready, go. Gonna pull the stops, gonna make it go.
Welcome back. Thanks for joining us. Well, it was a beautiful afternoon for some Duoc baseball yesterday when Loras went up to the plate against crosstown rival University of Dubuque. At the top of the first, UD freshman Daniel Casanova took advantage of an overthrow to first base, stealing second, then third. The Spartans continued their hot streak, gaining two more runs after Casanova that inning. Patrick Walsh had the first Duoc RBI, driving in Mike Pudlow to get Loras on the board. And Danny Felgren hits this sack fly to center, allowing freshman Tony Heinzer to score, leaving Loras down one at the end of the first inning. Although it started out close, the Spartans pulled away by the fifth inning, gaining six more runs, making it 9-2. The Duocs tried to answer in the bottom of the sixth. Cole Reed gets his first RBI of the game, followed by Mike Pudlow batting in another run. The spark of hope ended too soon, though, as the Spartans held the Duocs at four and added four more runs of their own, ending the game with a 13-4 win. Loras would reverse the script, defeating the Spartans 5-4 in the second game. The Duocs are at home again this Friday against Coe College.
Coming off a sweep against the Pioneers, the softball team battled the Beavers from Buena Vista here at Loras. The first game remained scoreless into the fourth inning when the Beavers jumped on the Duhawks, plating all of their six runs. Loras was able to muster one of their own in the bottom half. Then in the sixth, the Duhawks scored three, including this home run slammed out of the park by Katie Serpico. But it wasn't enough, and Loras fell 6-4. With hopes to rally in the second game, the Duhawks started off strong. In the third inning, the women knocked in four runs, including a homer by Elena Rigdon. Sam Schindler followed suit, crushing her own bomb in the fifth inning to bring the score 7-6 with the Beavers leading. Loras put up a fight, but BV claimed the game two and the sweep.
Well, after those tough losses on Saturday, the women are back in the diamond tonight against Wartburg.
That's where we find our very own Sports Zone reporter, Billy Rayfield. Billy, how are the women doing this evening?
Hey guys, I'm here at Faber-Clark. The Loras College Duhawks and the Wartburg Knights just finished their second game of their day-night doubleheader. In the first game, the Duhawks lost 7-5 to the Knights, but got revenge in the second game, beating the Knights 8-4. Sophomore first baseman Michaela Hasse hit her fifth home run of the season to left field to start the scoring for the Duhawks, giving them a 3-0 lead in the first. They didn't look back from there and beat them 8-4. They were happy to get the split in the doubleheader and get their first conference win of the season. But that's all I have here. Back to you guys.
All right, thank you, Billy.
The women will take the road this weekend at Central College.
The Duhawk track and field team started April with a fruitful weekend at Wartburg College. The women stole the spotlight when sophomore Maggie Science crossing the finish line first in the 5,000-meter run. Mary Rector follows suit in the 1,500. The men also ran to victory, with Zach Fry leading the 800-meter run and Sam Wan finishing triumphant in 1,500. The men and women finished fifth among nine schools on the day.
And now we're really excited to have the first ever men's volleyball coach in Loras history here with us tonight, Coach Jeremy Thornburg. Welcome to LCTV Live.
Thank you for having me. I really appreciate it.
You're welcome. So first off, tell us a little bit about yourself and your past before coming to Loras College.
Yeah, I did my undergrad at IPFW, a Division I institution with a men's program. I was a student assistant coach for my years there. And then I got a graduate assistant job with a women's team in Arkansas State University. Last year, I was an assistant coach in Florida at Eckerd College, a Division II program. And so, yeah, that's where I was before here.
You've been all over the place, huh?
Everywhere.
So what was the first thing you did when Bob Quinn told you that you actually got the job?
Honestly, I called my mother. That was
course,
the first thing I did. Mom was more than thrilled, and she, of course, was waiting on pins and needles, I think, more than me. That was the first thing I did. Then I called my mentor after that, one of my head coach from my undergrad, and let him know. So.
Gotcha. What are you most excited for when the season starts next spring?
I mean, honestly, it's hard to look that far in advance. Mm-hmm. Right now, I'm working so hard on the preparation and getting there, but there's nothing like game day for me. Mm-hmm. As a coach, you just look forward to it every week, every day. You know, the office stuff goes behind. That's not the fun stuff. The fun stuff is actually being in the gym and competing every day. So honestly, I can't wait to do that in the AWC. It's a great mm-hmm. facility. It's going to be great.
Awesome. Well, we're excited for that. So what's it like building a team from scratch? Have you had any challenges recently?
There are going to be challenges. It's not going to be easy. It's not going to be an easy road. But I know that, but that doesn't stop me. I'm going to be out every weekend recruiting, just trying to find those guys who aren't signed yet or committed, trying to get them to our program and get them to know about Loras, because I think once they know about Loras College and everything we have to offer here, I really think it's a great place, and I think that we can definitely get some great men's volleyball student athletes. So
hopefully we'll start up a good program.
Yeah.
So you said earlier that you did have experience with a women's team.
Mm-hmm.
Are there any strategic differences between men's and women's volleyball?
A lot of strategic differences.
Obviously, of course,
yeah. The game's relatively similar, but it's rather different when you're coaching. Obviously, coaching men and coaching women, it's rather different too. You can say one thing to a man and you can't say something to a woman all the time. But you know, it's still the same sport, and the passion, I don't think, changes from gender. So I just think finding those kids who are passionate, whatever sport it is and whatever gender they are, I think they're easy to coach, especially when you want the same thing as they do.
Absolutely. Well, Coach, thank you very much for joining us tonight, and good luck in the season.
Thank you very much.
All right. Well, the last team to join Loras before men's volleyball was lacrosse. And coming into Sunday's match, the Duhawks were riding a three-game skid, looking to bounce back at Augustana. However, the undefeated Vikings had complete control on the afternoon, getting the W 21-3. Caitlin Kutch kept her amazing season going, adding two more goals to mark her of 54. Anna Schwabli also got one in the back of the net for Loras. Hillary Cargill led the way for Augustana with two goals and seven. Yes, seven assists on the day. The woman will be back on the road on Friday at Aurora University.
Well, the Duhok men's golf team took to the links at Thunder Hills Country Club for the Duhok Spring Invitational. Taking on a dozen different teams, Loras qualified five golfers, including sophomore Ben Sahumski, who finished with a score of 154, which was good enough for a tie at 28th overall. Sophomore Jason Beer finished right behind Sahumski, tying for 32nd with a score of 155. Overall, the Duhoks finished 11th out of the 13 teams in the 2 days on the course.
Feels good. Finally got some weather that actually feels like golf weather, so instead of snow and wind, so it's nice.
The Duhoks golf again this weekend at the Wartburg Invite.
With spring upon us and golf season in full swing, reporter Greg Cormier decides to take his skills to the green.
Well, let's see how he did in this week's edition of Train Like a Duhok.
Hey guys, I'm here at Bunker Hill Golf Course with golfer Jim Daly, and today we're gonna go golfing. Jim, please don't make me look too bad.
Can't make any promises.
All right, let's do it to it. Beauty. Oh! I don't know if I'm gonna be able to find that ball. Oh, I hit the tree. Tree! I made it onto the green, but it was supposed to be that one. Jim here, he's crushing it. Way to go, dog. There we go, nice. No! Yeah! Five?
Five.
11. So, handsome lead by Jim. Nice.
Good job, sir.
You too, man. Way to go. Well, just finished a day of golf, and I learned from Jim here that I have a lot more to go. But Jim, thanks a lot for having me.
No problem, Greg.
Good luck with the rest of the season.
Thank you.
Back to you guys.
I really think Greg should stick with swimming and no other sport.
It just seems like there's no sport that yeah. he's good at besides swimming.
Honestly. Oh, well.
Well, maybe he can do better at tennis because the men's tennis team welcomed the Quahawks Tuesday, looking for their first W on the season. After grabbing some grueling volleys, the Duhoks were unable to match the skill that their undefeated conference competitors put forth. They lost the meet 9-0. Although the Duhoks are winless so far this season, senior Jess Castle remains hopeful the team's ability to grow.
Just keep on working on our games so that we're stronger for next season.
Loras will host University of Dubuque tomorrow.
Well, the madness of March is all over. Number 7 seed UConn won the NCAA basketball championship after a wild and crazy tournament.
And so with that, the LCTV bracket challenge is over, and we have some bragging rights to dish out.
And this year, we have a tie. Zach and Sports Zone producer Joel ended up tied for first place, with reporter Trey finishing just behind in third.
Well, all I needed was Florida to defeat UConn on Saturday, and I would have had the bragging rights all to myself, but Gators couldn't help me out.
Yeah, same thing with like the sports challenge, right?
Let's just not talk about that.
Anyways, yeah, it was a tough break for you, bud.
Mm-hmm.
But not for our audience, because actually it's time to give away some free Buffalo Wild Wings. So who's ready for that?
Woo!
Yeah.
All right, well, we'll ask a question, and the first person to raise their hand will have the first crack at getting some free B-dubs.
Here's your question. Which Loras golfer played a round of golf with Sports Zone's Greg Cormier? Is it A, John Nugent, B, Nicholas Martini, or C, Jimmy Daly?
So, Sarah, who gets the first shot?
All right. Who do we think? Right there in the middle. Black jacket, come on up here. All right, let's see how well you were paying attention. What do we think the answer is?
The answer was C.
Jimmy Daly, that is correct. Congratulations, and your name?
Jesse.
Jesse will be sure to get you your Buffalo Wild Wings gift card. Thank you. All right, Nina and Zach, right back to you guys.
All right, well, we'll be giving away more wings when we return to the studio on April 30th. Be sure to tune in then.
And Jesse, enjoy those wings.
And that's it for sports, but we've still got some competition ahead. Matt and Mariah are going to join us back up here for the first ever LCTV Anchor Challenge.
I don't think you're going to want to miss that. It's going to get pretty intense.
Definitely.
Well, we'll see you on the other side of the break.
I'm on myduhawk.com.
I'm on my Duhawk.
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 I'm on myduhawk.com. Are you?
Myduhawk.com. Delivering you Dubuque.
I find inspiration all around me. From those that push me to think and to grow. To move forward, because to stand still is to fall behind. That's not my plan. I'm just getting started. Now, just watch where I'll go. Loras College. Affordable, challenging, life-changing.
Welcome back. Now we're going to have a little fun with our anchors, Sports Zone versus LCTV in their first ever LCTV Anchor Challenge. We'll be testing their Loras knowledge with some trivia questions. Each question is worth 1 point. First team to 3 points wins. If one team gets it wrong, the other team has that chance to steal. So here we go. Let's flip a coin to get started. Do we have a coin? Okay. Oh, cameraman's got a coin. Let me take one. Thank you. Okay. All right, who wants to call heads or tails?
Heads.
Okay.
Tails, I guess.
Heads it is. All right, news. Let's begin. Let me open my envelope up. All right. When was Loras College founded?
1839.
That is correct. Impressive news, team. 1 point given to news. All right, sports, are you ready for your next question?
Yep. Absolutely.
All right. What two words came together to make the Loras College mascot?
Dog. Hawk.
So easy. Duhawk.
Write it down.
Duhawk? Duhawk? Duhawk. Dubuque, right? I mean, we're in Dubuque.
Then are you...
Well, let's go with it.
Try that.
Dubuque Hawk.
That is correct. Yes! It is tied 1-1.
What's up?
All right, news. On to the next question.
Okay, here we go.
What was the previous name of Loras College before it was named Loras College?
Yeah, let's go with Dubuque College.
I think that's right.
I think it's right.
Are you sure?
Wait, before it was named?
Before it was Loras College, it was named something else. What was that?
Columbia College.
Yeah. Excuse me.
We need the eraser.
We got this.
Do we have a time limit or something?
This.
Yeah,
we got it.
Yeah, I'm about to speed it up here.
Okay, there we go.
Columbia
College.
That is correct.
Yes.
All right, 2-1. All right.
Glad we know these.
Yeah, seriously. All right. Tied 1-1.
All right.
1-1. Yeah.
All right.
What was Wallert Hall previously known as? Ten.
The library.
Correct.
Wow, I didn't even know
okay,
that.
For some reason, me and
can't stump up.
Joel Schmidt, the producer of the show, and myself, we came up with these ideas, and I totally thought they were going to be harder than they were for you. So let's trick you up a little. This is why I have a bonus question lined up.
Okay, here we go.
Okay. Recite the fight song.
Are you kidding?
I don't know.
No?
I'm a
senior.
No?
Wait, like, how much do I have to recite?
Just like a section.
All right, how about this one? What year did President Collins graduate from Loras?
Ooh.
This is for the win.
This is it.
Okay. For the win, both of you give an answer.
Get this one. No.
Hurry.
4, 3, 2.
Okay. All right. New sports, go ahead first.
1984.
Okay.
Ooh, I think we're going to go with 1985.
The answer is 1984. Sports. Oh. I will let you guys fight over whatever the punishment's going to be for the two of you.
Oh,
so,
we'll think
excuse me.
Okay.
Oh, boy.
Wow.
So, what's this punishment going
to
be?
Well, it looks like we're running out of time here.
No.
So, yeah.
We want to say thank you to our live audience for joining us here in the pub tonight.
We'll be taking a couple weeks off for our spring break.
But on April 30th, Sports Zone will be back to give you the latest and greatest in Duhawk athletics.
So thanks for watching and have a great night.